Grace to you and peace in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to worship at Duke University Chapel, where this morning we are celebrating Christ the King Sunday, already starting off with music which speaks to Christ's majesty. This morning, our guest preacher is the Reverend Dr. Christopher Beeley, Professor of Theology, Anglican Studies, and Ministry at Duke Divinity School. It is our joy to welcome him to our service today, and we look forward to his message for us. Please take a moment to read the announcements in your worship guide this morning. As you will see, there are quite a number of events to which you are invited. This afternoon, there will be a Bach cantata concert at 5 o'clock. Following that, on other days, there will be a choral concert, Messiah performance, and a Advent service of lessons and carols. In addition, there is an Advent book study. All of those are opportunities for you, and I invite your participation. Now let us rise as we are able to sing to the God who is beyond all praising.
Thank you. O people of the earth, we come before the Lord not as despised sinners, but as beloved children. Let us not hide our faults and failings in the dark, but instead open ourselves up to the light of Christ's love. With prayer, together, let us approach God and humbly confess our sins. Let us pray. Holy God, we confess that we have turned from you. We have lived for ourselves and ignored your call to join in more fruitful community. So often we choose comfort over compassion, apathy over emotions. We hide away and do not pause long enough to heed your whispering, whirling word. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Redeeming Christ, so often we turn from what is easy and avoid what is difficult. We would rather stay cozily wrapped in our own concerns rather than do the hard work of listening and loving and learning from others. Find us in the fog of our sin. Teach us a new way of being. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Renewing Spirit, we confess that we sin sometimes with intention, sometimes on accident. At times we know the pain we cause, and other times we do not know our own harm. Pursue us again with your grace. Forgive us with your bounty. Break and remake our hearts until they become more like yours. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Friends, we hear these words, we pray these words of confession together, and then we hear these words of assurance together. Once we were no people, now we are God's people. Our sin will never be the end of our story. The love of Christ will have the final word every time. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. So claimed by grace and called by love, we begin the work of peace now. Let us take a moment through our word or gesture and pass the peace of Christ to all those around us, carrying these testimonies of peace out into the world after our worship. The peace of Christ be with you all.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your worship guide. God the Father, help us to hear the call of Christ the King and to follow in his service, for he reigns forever with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, one glory. Amen. The first lesson is from Psalm 93. The Lord is King. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He is girded with strength. He has established the world. It shall never be moved. Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their roaring. More majestic than the thunders of mighty waters, more majestic than the waves of the sea, majestic on high is the Lord. Your decrees are very sure. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, forevermore. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Old Testament lesson is from Daniel, the 7th chapter. As I watched, thrones were set in place, and an ancient one took his throne. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, and its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and flowed out from his presence. 1,000 thousands served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood attending him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were opened. As I watched in the night visions, I saw one like a human being coming with clouds from heaven. And he came to the ancient one and was presented before him. To him was given dominion and glory and kingship, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not pass away, and his kingship is one that shall never be destroyed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The gospel lesson is from John, the 18th chapter. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Jesus said, "My kingdom is not from this world. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth." May I speak to you in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning. It's wonderful to be with you this morning, just across the way from my usual home over in the Divinity School, and I'm very grateful for the invitation to preach to you this morning from my colleague, Dean Luke Powery. It's wonderful to be here. And today we're celebrating the feast of Christ the King, or the reign of Christ, that comes on this last Sunday of the conventional church year. Next Sunday, if you haven't already noticed, is the first Sunday of Advent. So here we are with Christ the King. Jesus said, "My kingdom is not from this world." On this day, we think together about what it means to have a kingdom, to have rule, the real nature and the real purpose of all might and sovereignty and power in our world, such as we know it, and beyond our world. This morning, I'll be speaking to you about what we might call the principles for a Christian politics. The image of a king or a queen or a ruler or a president or a chairwoman or chairman or whatever will evoke, for most of us, fond memories, imaginations, and literary resemblances of what it means to be a king or a queen. It's not something that we have to manufacture. You just have to show up at an event where someone is doing something especially glorious or noteworthy, and your heart just expands and you get excited. Or you see a royal procession. Or you remember people in your life who had special blessing, the blessing of power and authority for you personally. And there are thousands and thousands of such examples. We seem to be hardwired to have heroes, to have leaders, to have people that we trust for activities that are greater than our own power. But the idea of being a king or a queen, I want to suggest to you, and I'll come back to this in the end, also has very much to do with what we are about here as a university at Duke. All of our aspirations for excellence, for professional skill, for artistic beauty, and other forms of competence are also images of God's eternal kingship. The idea that Christ is our King is an uplifting one and an inspiring one indeed. At the same time, at one point or another, we all have a sense that the present order of the world is not exactly how it should be. The world is broken. We sense and yearn and even weep that there must be a more just way of being together than we know. Now, most often, to be honest, our desires for justice and righteousness on the earth can often come from what we deserve or want, or what we think we deserve. They can come even from a sense of pity, which is not the same thing as love. But occasionally, thank God, we do have glimpses of real concern for others in the world around us for their own sake, and we do long for God's righteous rule in the world because to some small extent we love, or at least we want to love, true justice. Now, in both respects, the selfish and the selfless, our longing is a good one. It is a vestige of God's own life and character that has been given to us even with our broken minds and wills, and so we can learn something even from our own yearnings by God's grace. You don't need me to cite a lot of examples or to go on about the many travesties and abuses and tragedies of human power that we live with, and in many cases have suffered directly. Human rule is often a dark parody of real leadership or kingship. It makes me think of St. Augustine's unsparing words for the character of the Roman Empire, the society of his day. Organized as it was, he perceives rightly, around the love of glory, the love of violence, and lust for other bodies. Augustine's words about Rome, of course, speak equally well to the society in which we live. One of the most central beliefs of the people of Israel about their God is that the true king is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God is the righteous sovereign, the one in whom alone we look to and see what real kingship is. These beautiful words from Psalm 93 this morning: the Lord is king, he has put on splendid apparel. Ever since the world began, your throne has been established. You, O God, are from everlasting. Mighty is the Lord who dwells on high. God is the true king, and despite our fantasies of our own power, God is the only one whose power will endure. On the feast of Christ the King, we're also offered different readings of these apocalyptic visions of God's eternal kingship and that of Christ the Lamb. Some years we hear from the Revelation to John. This year, this Sunday, we hear from Daniel chapter 7 in this marvelously symbolic, imaginative vision that came in a dream. It's a vision of an ancient one who took the throne, and his clothing was white as snow. His throne was fiery flames, and a stream of fire issued from his presence. 10,000 times 10,000 stood attending him. Majesty, power, and judgment beyond anything that we could concoct. But there was something more. Daniel tells us that then one like a son of man or a human being came with the clouds of heaven, and he was presented to the Lord on the throne. The Son of Man who comes represents a fifth kingdom in addition to the four kingdoms of the earth that we've been reading about in the book of Daniel. Above and beyond the kingdoms of the world comes the true and divine King, which will supersede all of the others. To him, to the Son of Man, is given dominance, dominion, glory, and kingship, so that all peoples and nations and languages would serve him, and he would have an everlasting dominion. Christians, of course, have read this always as a prophecy of the coming of Christ, the King of the world. God's kingship is abundantly clear in the pages of the scriptures of Israel. The king is mighty and he loves justice above all, reads Psalm 99. The mark of God's kingship, unlike most of our own, is that God cares for the poor first. God always strives to maintain justice. God, the king, protects the people, especially the most vulnerable and those who are left out of the worldly economy and systems of power. And through it all, and above all, God, the righteous king, brings blessing and well-being, protection and prosperity for God's people. One of the most staggering things about the Gospels is that the Lord Jesus himself claimed this identity as king. He had already moved about among his contemporaries, his enemies, and his friends as one entirely free of all of the powers of the world or the universe. He had already acted and spoke like one who was in charge, even if we might not have noticed it. The confession that Christ is Lord, Kurios Christos, is one of the very oldest statements of faith. Christ is Lord. Christ is the sovereign over all the earth. Christ is the true and the real ruler, not the earthly rulers who pretend to hold sway as if they were God. Christ is Caesar. Christ is the King of all kings. So when he enters Jerusalem, Luke tells us in his gospel, Jesus performed an unmistakable act of royal entry. First, he comes from the Mount of Olives, the place where God is expected to appear on the day of the Lord to become king over all the earth, as Zechariah prophesies. Then Christ requisitions the colt on which he will ride into the city, and an unridden one as required. The people spread their cloaks to welcome the new king, and they cry out, "Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord." But his enemies want them to be silenced. Some of the Pharisees tell his disciples, "You need to make them stop that because it's threatening." And Jesus replies, "If they were silent, the very stones would cry out." Ukachukwumanus writes in his book, Christ the African King, that the images of Christ's kingship that we have in the Gospels and in the prophets reflect very well some of the most beloved images of kingship in pre-colonial, pre-conquest Africa, and it's a lesson to many of us, most of us who come from other kinds of societies with colonial legacies, an image not only of the one who cares first and last for his tribe or his people, but indeed who is willing to give his life for their sake, if necessary. Jesus tells Pilate, "My kingdom is not from this world. It is of a different kind altogether." This King Jesus that we celebrate today had a coronation. He was crowned. And his coronation was his death on the cross and his resurrection. The real identity of Jesus the King, the nature of God's kingship altogether, can never be understood apart from the crowning of King Jesus. The rulers of the earth are crowned in beautiful palaces, with noble on noble thrones and in fine linen, but the King of the universe is crowned on a cross, where he gave his life for the healing and the salvation of the world. The principles and the figures and heroes and the systems that we tend to substitute for Christ's kingship, all of this, without exception, every single one of them, is an idol, a false god, and the instrument of the enslavement of others and of our own souls, if we do not see first who the real King is and what he did on our behalf. There is, Paul tells us, no name under heaven or earth by which we will be saved, and who rules and governs and cares for God's beautiful creation, other than the name of Jesus Christ crucified and risen. And apart from his saving work of confronting and transforming the very root and the presence of the evil that enslaves us, his work not of best practices and incremental solutions and good intentions. No, his work was to destroy sin, to defeat death, and to conquer the devil himself. Apart from that work, our best intentions will always go awry. Now, this is a hard word, I realize. But this applies to all of those countless acts and policies and important gestures, human efforts to right the wrongs of society, whether Christ is being acknowledged or not. Christ's kingship and his sovereign providence for the earth does not depend in the least on our acknowledgement for the sake of others, even though for our own sakes, we must choose to participate if we want to share. Apart from Christ's creating and redeeming and consummating power, everything we do, in the end, will be dross. If this is hard to hear, then it is a call for us to become awake, to become his disciples. And as we are his followers, we will also understand what glorious and life-giving good news it is for us. We have on the color of our bulletins this morning this wonderful image of an icon of Christ the King painted in Greece. I cannot claim credit for this. This was put on here by the chapel staff. I'm the beneficiary as you are, but I won't comment on it. This is a version derivative of an image, an earlier image called Christ the Pantocrator, the ruler of all things. And in a late Byzantine and Russian style, you see Jesus crowned with a crown, and he's robed in royal apparel, which echoes the garments that he wore when he rode that colt into the city of Jerusalem in the face of his enemies. He holds up his hand in a symbol of blessing, and his fingers make for us the letters of the word that spells his name, Jesus, in Greek. It's an image that's deeply paradoxical. It shows forth his splendor and the remnants, the history, and the eternal reality of his death and his resurrection for us. Notice finally that as Jesus looks at us through this image, his expression contains all that he is. He looks at us with peace, with compassion, and also with judgment and with power, all wrapped up in one. It's become a favorite pastime, especially for understandable reasons at this point in our own society, has it not, to argue and debate about what the authorities are or are not or ought to be doing, how poorly certain people do their jobs or don't, what sort of services we need and we require, and why don't people give us more say and more sway? Much of that is important, even crucial. But the most important question before and beyond all of that is not how well other people are ruling or how well we are ruling in our own offices. The question is, how well are we being ruled? How well are we being ruled by the true King, God, in Jesus Christ? It's only when we allow ourselves to be ruled by him that we have any hope of being a blessing to others. The 19th century theologian and social ethicist F.D. Morris wrote this about Jesus' preaching of his kingdom. In his constant preaching, it's as if, Morris says, Jesus was saying to us, there has been a holy and a blessed order among you. The order of the nation of Israel, God's chosen people. But you have been darkening and confounding and hiding from others by your sins and your selfishness this beautiful thing. But it must and it will assert itself on the earth in spite of you and of all who resist it. Christ's kingship cannot be stopped by us, however much damage we may perform. To rule in Christ and to be ruled by Christ, having Christ as our King, is not a nice image to put on the shelf alongside of a bunch of others as if they were the same. Christ the King is our Creator. He is our Judge, and he is the Savior of all. Queens and kings and leaders, etc. The blessing of the world for which we all rightly yearn and to which I hope we have given ourselves requires discipleship. It requires the humility of obedience. It requires courage. And it requires care for the lowly and the neediest among us. When we do that, we might look a little bit like Christ, the King of Kings. To conclude, the reign of Christ begins within ourselves. It begins, as Jesus said, in the human heart. But it will make itself manifest without. Christ's reign, I'm quoting Morris again, must penetrate our feelings, our habits, our thoughts, our words, and our acts for all of us who desire to be subject to him. At last, we know, we trust, and we hope it will penetrate the entirety of cosmic existence. So this is what we pray when we pray, as we will together in a few minutes, thy kingdom come. May your reign come, O God. This is what we pray. We yearn for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to reign over our spirits and our souls and our bodies, which are his and which he has redeemed. We pray for the extinction of all tyranny, whether lodged in particular people or in systems and multitudes. We pray for the exposure and the destruction of all corruption, inward or outward. We pray for truth in all of the halls of power, and in art and in science, the halls of learning. We pray for the true dignity of all human work. We pray for right dealings in the commonest transactions of our commerce. And we pray for blessing that will be felt in every home, trusting and knowing that God will hear us. God will answer our prayer, "Thy kingdom come," so that everything that he has made, all of it, one day, will become as it was meant to be, in the name and the glory of Christ the King, forever and forever. Amen.
With the people of God through all the ages, let us stand and confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you have risen to rule the world. It is your realm in which we live, move, and have our being, and it is your truth which calls to us. Open us to recognize your kingdom that we may see your work in our world. Deepen our trust in you, so that when vision fails, we may still rest in the assurance of knowing that you are Lord of all. Humble us to accept your authority in our lives, and move us to set aside our own desires for power or control. Reassure us of your all-encompassing love, that we may experience the empowering freedom of knowing we belong to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, you are with us from the rising of the sun to its setting, even as your grace extends to all parts of the world. We are mindful today of neighbors near and far who need your care. Be with children in all lands, that they may have the love and opportunities they need to thrive. Be with migrants as they walk through Mexico or Belarus seeking a new life. Protect them from harm and make a way for a new beginning. Be with those who are incarcerated, bringing calm to those who riot in Ecuador's jails and bringing comfort to those who sit on death row. Be with those we know who are ill or injured, bringing them healing and wholeness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, move now among us to strengthen our sense of gratitude. As we celebrate Thanksgiving this week, move us to name and savor all that is good within our lives. Help us to notice the little things that bring us joy, to celebrate the love we find in the people around us, and to praise you for the gift of your unending grace. When we face challenges or pain, enable us to continue to find ways to give you thanks and praise, opening our hands to receive your blessings. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Trusting Jesus as Lord of all, we offer these prayers in his name. Amen. This morning, we have the privilege of hearing from Mr. David Rees, the president and CEO of Durham Children's Initiative. He is here to tell us about the work they do in the community.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm David Rees, president of the Durham Children's Initiative. You know, 10 years ago, a group of Durhamites got together and decided that they were going to change outcomes for kids. They also decided that they shouldn't do it by themselves. They should bring together people from throughout Durham, ask the questions, what works, what doesn't work, what would you change? We fast forward, and we've created what now has become the most comprehensive cradle-to-college model in the state of North Carolina, where this morning we literally had babies born into the Durham Children's Initiative. And this past May, we had young people who graduated from college. We're also preparing for this new cohort of college of high school seniors, which will be graduating this coming May. You know, as we think about our work, this is really about a movement within Durham. We chose a zone, 120 blocks, 1.2 square miles, had the highest rates of crime, teen pregnancy, substance abuse, childhood abuse and neglect, but the lowest performing elementary, middle, and high school. And we decided as a community that this was unacceptable. And we would then bring together high quality interventions and wrap young people with supports. You know, we woke up about 8 years ago and pinched ourselves because we realized that it was working. That we had 93% of our kindergarten ready young people, kindergarten ready. That we actually were able to stop learning loss over the course of the summers. And that we actually were having young people and their families who were moving forward and having all of the academic and social success that they expected and thought that they should have, and actually was actually beyond the dreams that we thought they should have and that they could actually go ahead and achieve. I want to take a moment and I want to celebrate our parents. These are the essential workers. These are the folks that you come in contact with every single day. We recognize the value of our parents, not only because of the work they did with our young people, but we recognize their value during this pandemic. You see, our parents didn't have the opportunity to take the day off. In addition to that, they also didn't have the opportunity not to learn how to be the teacher of their young person during these last 18 months. And so as we move towards this period of Thanksgiving, you know, us at the Durham Children's Initiative are tremendously thankful for our essential workers who were the essential parents, who were the essential teachers, and who were the essential keepers of their home. The next couple of months we know will be tremendously challenging for our young people. They're back in school, they're in person, they're learning not only academically, but also socially what it means to live in a post-pandemic environment. But we also know with the support of you all, with the support of their essential parents, that they're on the path for success. I want to leave you with a charge. I want you to think about where are you in that pipeline of success? Where are you plugging in? Remember, I started this with, this is the movement, a movement back in Durham as we think about the success of young people here in our community. So we're at a place of Thanksgiving where we'll all be with our families and our loved ones. giving thanks. Where will you fit in as you begin to give thanks and support those who are essential to our world that we know today? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reese. Our offering this morning will go to support the Durham Children's Initiative to help build that pathway to from cradle to college and career. And in addition to financial offerings which support this initiative, DCI also welcomes volunteers to mentor, to support those children in a variety of ways. Those opportunities are available on their website. Let us give of our time and our talent and our treasure to support the next generation.
Eternal God, creator of the world and mother of all good, we thank you for these gifts, for all the earth, our home, and for the treasure of life. You have sent Jesus, your son, to be our King of Kings. We rejoice that he has triumphed over all other powers and principalities. Because he lives, we live to serve you alone, our God who dwells with the least of these on earth. Send us now forth, burning with justice, peace, and love, with your holy ones of all times and places, with earth and all its creatures, with sun, moon, and stars. May we yet again thank you and praise you, O God, our blessed and holy Trinity, the one who comes among us and teaches us to pray the words of Christ, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, Jesus says, My kingdom is not from this world. We say, Come quickly, Lord Jesus. Therefore, as God's own, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, and patience, forgiving one another as the Lord has forgiven you, and crown all of these things with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And in the name of the Almighty Christ, who knows what it is to be among the least of the earth, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.